Looking deep into the universe is like taking a trip down memory lane. The farther from Earth we look, the farther back in time we see. The farther back in time we see.
I
like it.
Yeah.
Just a little bit. I know they always get Zach and the H and the K confused, but
yeah.
that was like the only thing. It was a kick butt entrance.
Very much.
I love the also struck Zarathustra, the tribute to, woo, the Nature Boy.
Not to mention the chokeslam of the century where Mankind fell over on the cell by the Undertaker.
Tall stuff on the cell. I love it. Love it. Big shout out to the producers. Loved it. Mm-hmm. All right.
Way to work, guys.
And welcome. Of course, I am your host, your connection to the wrestling world, Ken Hill, alongside me, back today, this week, is my good friend, the madman, the Luna Wolf of professional wrestling, Mr. Zach Martinkus.
What up, everybody? It's good to be back. Coming back from, just the last days of college. And for those who are wondering, though, I passed with line colors. 91.6. Aced it.
Nice. So, congratulations, my man.
Thanks, man.
All right. But sadly, we go from some good news to some not so good news in the world of wrestling today.
Yeah.
We start with This Week in Review, and we start with the debacle. Even before This Week in Review, we have a special presentation we'd like to do.
Mm-hmm.
As you may remember, Zach and I do a monthly friendly contest, mm-hmm, where he and I make predictions for the pay-per-views,
mm-hmm,
and whoever comes on top gets to hold what we now dub the WK King of Pay-Per-Views Championship, which will be defended at every monthly pay-per-view.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, came out with perfect 8-for-8 at Extreme Rules. So, of course, you have your inaugural champion, so to speak. We have our friend here, Stanley, here to present the belt today.
Yeah, dude.
Take it out. I will.
Yeah, look at that.
Dude, maybe the pay-per-view champion, but I am the true legit champion.
We'll see.
Oh, I'm not afraid to defend this, man. You want to give me challenge any of the week, dude? I'll face you one-on-one.
Maybe another time, madman. All right. So moving on to This Week in Review, some sour news, if you will. We have the Kane Bryan situation, which took a turn for the worse for the WWE World Heavyweight Champion. We found out earlier this week, courtesy of Daniel Bryan, that he would be undergoing neck surgery because he suffered some nerve damage, as a result of the Extreme Rules match with Kane, and thankfully it would be minimally invasive surgery. However, Stephanie and Kane weren't willing to just let Bryan go out on a high note. Stephanie wanted to deal with the situation concerning the WWE World Heavyweight Championship. So later, after Bryan made his announcement, Stephanie would call out Bryan to the ring, except that it didn't quite go the way that either she or, of course, Brian wanted. Mm-hmm. Kane's pyro hits, and then this happened. Oh, small technical error, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, as you can see here, Kane dragged Brian out to the ring. You could see he was bruised beyond belief. He was beaten. His clothes were torn. Kane just absolutely decimated Brian to the point where he had to be stretchered out alongside his wife Brie Bella. And thankfully, we heard that surgery took place this past Thursday. Brian, it was a complete success. Brian's going to be out for roughly 6 to 8 weeks. So we here at the Wrestling Connection, all the fans, wish nothing but the best for Brian. A speedy recovery. We know he'll be back in the ring sooner than later. The estimated time for Brian is around SummerSlam. So, of course, we hope Brian doesn't miss the biggest party of this summer in professional wrestling.
Amen to that. Yeah, I guess, like, just the big question is, like, now, I mean, since Daniel Bryan's going to be out for the next couple of weeks, like...
Well, the next couple of months.
The next couple of months, my bad. What are they going to do for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship? I mean...
Well, that was discussed in the weekly meeting between Michael Cole and Triple H on WWE.com, mm-hmm. And Triple H said that the authority would handle the WWE World title situation this coming Monday. Now, considering the history between the authority and Daniel Bryan, you gotta take that news with a grain of salt, because you never know what Triple H has in mind. He could let Bryan keep the title the next 2 months, or he could just go ahead and just have it vacated outright, or, as he quoted it in 2013, held in abeyance.
I won't be surprised if they...
Honestly, Bayance has had a longer championship reign than Daniel Bryan has.
Yeah.
So anyway, speaking of Triple H, the next step war between Evolution and the Shield was fired. The Shield, responding to the massive beatdown from Evolution, capped off with their mockery of a triple powerbomb. The Shield came right out at the beginning of the show, called Evolution out. As soon as Orton, Batista, and Triple H arrived, the Shield jumped them and beat them down. They had to be held back by officials. but then when the Evolution came out later to call out the Shield for the beatdown, because they were sick of it, they call them out. Suddenly the Shield jumps them again. They're relentless here. And while Evolution makes a hasty retreat. Here you see a litany of superstars coming out. You see Fandango, Ryback, Curtis Axel, Damian Sandow, members of 3MB, all trying to get the jump on the Shield, only for the Shield to not only escape with Roman Reigns spearing Triple H again, mm-hmm. but then once Reigns is getting beat down by all these different superstars, Ambrose and Rollins come to the rescue with steel chairs, laying out all these guys, laying out Ryback with another triple power bomb, and all Evolution can do is just look on in disbelief. Essentially, their master plan for this week backfired. While the Shield evolved once again, here you see Batista, Triple H, and Orton just looking on in disbelief.
Hey, you don't mess with the Hounds of Justice.
Indeed, and it makes you really wonder if Triple H had the right idea in challenging the Shield to a rematch, because the way this is going, history is going to end up repeating itself.
Yeah.
Whereas Evolution seems to be taking steps backward, ironically enough, mm-hmm. the Shield just keep making bigger and bigger steps. The numbers game is no longer a factor. The Evolution is going to have to find a different way to get through to the Shield.
Yeah, you can't. I mean, this is like going back to, you know, the debut of around the time that the Shield debuted. They were vicious back then. They're still vicious even to this day. And it's funny, even after 3 years, They're still 2 or 3 years. They're still dominant. Evolution. I'm sorry, but you can either evolve or adapt or perish. Yeah, you guys are basically you're falling.
You're falling. You're perishing before our very eyes. So I mean.
So basically, evolution. This is your judgment. Guilty, and you're done. Payback. They're gonna take you all down once again, and I'm praying to God, Reigns, please spear Triple H like there's no tomorrow, straight to the ground. Please, I'm begging you, and give him the triple power bomb for Pete's sake.
Well, we're all begging for that.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So on a smaller note, before we move into the Ken's Den and Zack Attack, a bit of a funny note with the second week. Following the debut of the party man himself, Adam Rose, stripped fresh from NXT, he interrupted a segment with Coulter and Jack Swagger, where Zeb Coulter was ready to add another name to his ever growing deportation list.
Oh,
as you can see here.
Okay, we got it. Okay.
Yes, you see right here, of course, Cesaro, Heyman, Emma, Santino, Sheamus, Paige, and now the newest name, Adam Rose.
Oh, jeez.
All who Coulter has accused, and I may use Coulter's actual vernacular, sneaking across the border, and Adam Rose and then Swagger later has a match with RVD, and with Rob Van Dam, and then suddenly here comes Adam Rose and his party posse, the Exotic Express, if you will. They're just having a good time. They're dancing. They're jumping. It's all crazy. It's all good, and this does nothing but distract Swagger. Adam Rose jumps up on the ring. He's duking and jiving. And then Swagger comes over to take a swing at him. And then, as you see here, Adam Rose just dives right back into the crowd. But not all nonchalant. He's just out there having a good time. Swagger gets distracted. All it takes is one kick from RVD, 5-star frog splash, and Swagger is completely, and Swagger's down and out.
Yeah, this doesn't remind me the 15th anniversary of Raw when RVD versus Santino. One kick.
Yeah, exactly.
He's out like a light.
Exactly.
Shocking, awe.
I mean, the party, I like the party gimmick. He's fun, he's wild, he's kind of like a PG-rated godfather, if you will. He has this big following. He has all these party people coming out. Everyone's having a good time. But we haven't seen him wrestle yet. We haven't really seen the in-ring debut, which is rumored to be versus Jack Swagger at WWE Payback.
Oh God, this should be interesting.
I'm
sorry though, but just, I hate to kind of put remind a little bit of certain things of Impact, but yeah, this doesn't remind me too much of.
You mean the menagerie?
Yeah, that's what the heck I meant, yeah.
Had a little technical difficulty with the sound right there.
Yeah. So, yeah, and what I'm kind of referring to, though, for those who are watching Impact, just I'm going to give a little bit of a brief little dealio with this group. It's basically something like Juggalo World.
Let's not split hairs.
It's something close to it though. But
I mean all these different independent wrestling promotions. I mean, we understand that we try to appeal to just a general audience, and I'm sure there are a few wrestling fans out there who have a good idea what we're talking about.
Yeah.
We do tend to split hairs every once in a while. I mean, we'll talk about TNA wrestling. We talk about all these different independent promotions like Ring of Honor, Juggalo World Wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, but for the most part, we try to bring people to the forefront of professional wrestling, WWE. I mean, later on, once we get everyone acclimated, and I make this promise to you, that once we get everyone acclimated, settled into the understanding of professional wrestling, we can start talking, we can expand more. We can start talking more about TNA, about Ring of Honor. We can bring to you more local wrestlers, people you can connect with easier than all the big stars up in WWE. All
right.
But moving on. Sorry for a little diatribe right there. We move on to Ken. We move on to this week's edition of Ken's Den. Now, this week's edition of Ken's Den, I have a bit of an interesting call. It's not just one particular wrestler. In fact, it's not even a wrestler. It's the Divas division that I want to call out. Because we saw this past week that Paige had a solid defense, had a solid match against Alicia, against a wily Alicia Fox. And bless you. And yet, I mean, this is the first time we've really seen a diva outside of AJ Lee or Tamina or Paige really motivated, like really wrestling an actual wrestling match, not just a 2-minute divas match where they just like sort of flop around and pull each other's hair. So we actually saw like slams and backbreakers and suplexes. We saw actual wrestling holds rather than just like a chin lock for 2 minutes, and then suddenly a finish comes out of nowhere. The point is that rumor has it that Fit Finlay has taken back over for training the Divas, and I think this is for the best, because when Finlay was in charge of the Divas division way back, he motivated them. He motivated them not just to look good, but to fight good. To fight good, to be aggressive, while still looking drop-dead gorgeous at the same time. And I think that's what the new crop of Divas has here. Now that you have Paige as a champion, now that you actually have a real fighting champion in your midst, the rest of the Divas, you need to pick things up. You need to start having that same kind of attitude that Alicia Fox had this past week. When I saw Alicia Fox snap, and we're gonna elaborate on it more in the superstar profile, when she snapped, that was like the most surreal segment I've seen, because for the first time I saw a diva with attitude. I saw a diva that actually, you know, cares about wanting to be Divas champion, not just going out there and looking good and being eye candy for a couple minutes. I like to see not just divas motivated, I like to see wrestlers that are motivated. But in this case, I like seeing the divas motivated to want to be champion and to want to knock Paige off her pedestal so soon after being champion.
All right. Oh, that's pretty strong, tough words. It doesn't make a lot of sense, because the Divas have been kind of lagging ever since, you know, AJ was the Divas champion.
Right, because AJ pretty much had the belt all to herself. She had Tamina at her side. Pretty much no one could touch her until she made that challenge to Paige, and Paige upset her for the championship. Mm-hmm. Now you have this upstart champion that everyone wants to get, who just came out of nowhere, won the championship. Now all the Divas suddenly realize, oh, I have a chance to be Divas champion and get more airtime on TV.
Yeah, which, it was your time. Let's see how long their 15 minutes of fame should really last. So, well, for me, for, Paige, do not try this at home. He's the phenom. He's the phenom. He's the phenom. Lights out.
Lights out.
We want this boy. Your fear is in my domain. Put up or shut up.
Your fear is in my domain. Recognize.
Wow.
I love it. I think the producer saw that was a, that's just, that's awesome. I love it. oh, wow.
Even the Bigfoot. Even the Bigfoot photo.
Yeah, wow. Okay, moving on.
All right, I got to tip my hat to producers.
Oh God. Right. Okay.
Two for two.
Yep. All right.
So who do you have in mind for the Zack Attack this week?
Oof. I did have in mind though. I was gonna make a little joke about you saying though how you know it'd be kind of cool though. Would be the face you maybe someday for this. Would be interesting.
What could be?
Yeah, but in all honesty, mine isn't just one, isn't just two, it's three. Uh-oh. And it's actually the members of Evolution. Now, over the last few weeks, I've been paying attention to how you guys have been trying to do. I'm sorry, but since when the heck did you guys decide to pay, you know, 14 individuals to sell you guys as matter? I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't 10 years ago when you... I'm sorry, 11 years...
11 years ago.
Yeah.
That was around the time they were big.
Yeah. So 10, 11 years ago, you guys were the biggest faction in history. All four of you guys. Batista, Ric Flair, World Tag Team titles. Randy Orton, the Intercontinental title. Triple H... the World Heavyweight Championship.
No, you were untouchable.
Yeah, you guys were basically freaking untouchable. And now...
And pretty much you ruled the... They ruled the numbers game.
Not to mention they overcame Raw. Now...
They took over Raw. There was pretty much no individual or team that could ever touch them.
Exactly. So, how exactly is it did you guys go from being pretty much an unstoppable force years ago to basically a... what I'm going to call a chicken version of that. Really? Either evolve or adapt.
You adapt or perish?
Yeah, or whatever. I don't give a rat's rear end. In all honesty, you morons need to freaking get your memos in check. Because the way you guys are going, seems like you guys really got the crap kicked out of you at Extreme Rules, and you keep trying to play the numbers game and whatnot, though. You guys ain't worth crap. You guys, evolve or perish, you guys are pretty much perishing, and I swear, you guys should believe in the Shield, don't believe in Evolution, believe in the Shield.
I mean, they've been playing, they play the numbers, they are, I mean, just because they're missing, just because I think ever since Flair endorsed the Shield, they don't have that same numbers game. It's always been 3-on-3. So now they have to hire like a dozen different guys to come out and do their dirty work.
Right.
And the Shield has already overcome that. They've beaten down these same dozen guys. Left and right. They devastated them on SmackDown a couple weeks ago. They did the same on Raw.
Yeah.
The bottom line is the numbers game no longer has a factor here. The Evolution has to go at the Shield head on. Otherwise they're done.
Yeah, pretty much.
They're done. The only way I could see Evolution coming on top is some sort of stipulation. Supposedly it's rumored that there's going to be a stipulation added to the six-man tag.
Possibly
an elimination tag, possibly no disqualification. You never know. I mean, something that could potentially favor Evolution. Well, it remains to be seen. Now, we have a very special superstar profile this week. It's the first ever diva profile, the first ever female superstar profile.
Alicia Fox. And all I can say from that photo is
meow.
Ooh la la.
Meow.
Wolf.
Well, Alicia Fox was first brought onto WWE in 2006 alongside Kelly Kelly as one of the many, many models hired by then senior talent relations. John Laurinaitis. She was brought up to WWE programming in 2000 8, originally as the wedding planner for Edge and Vicky Guerrero. Once the bottom fell on that, she then became a manager of a lesser-known talent in ECW known as DJ Gabriel.
Worst and gimmick ever since the Human Body Cast.
Very true. I mean, he was there for a cup of coffee, but they kept Alicia around. Mm. She would go on to perform on ECW for a couple more years, then SmackDown, eventually working her way up to the Raw roster, where in 2010 she won her first and only to this day Divas Championship, infamously becoming known to one of her promos as the Undefined Divas Champion rather than Undisputed Divas Champion. A moniker that has stuck with her to this day.
Ugh. Now, at least it's not like Chris Jericho saying that I am the first ever undisputed champion.
Yeah, she's the first ever undefined Divas champion.
Yeah, there's a cup of coffee for you.
Yeah.
Ah!
Okay. And recently, I mean, she's just kind of drifted along on the WWE television. Mm-hmm. She hasn't really made any waves until this past week, where in her match with Paige, Alicia just kind of came out with an attitude. She badmouthed the audience. She was mouthing off to the commentators, to the announcers, and then like you saw right there, she just sort of had a breakdown at ringside. She was headlocking announcers. She stole JBL's cowboy hat. She tore apart the ringside area. She just had a complete. I kind of envy those two.
I don't know though. I probably would be freaking out if that'd be the case. Though. Actually, I'm sorry, but it just looks like, you know, I would say
she was actually sinking, and she was trying to get them to join along. She was going completely nuts, and that's what I was talking about. She actually finally has attitude. Diva that's finally showing attitude besides Paige, who cares about wins and losses, who cares about wanting to be Divas champion. That's what I want to see in the Divas division. Pretty much like the tag team resurgence, I want to see a resurgence for women's wrestling in WWE. And I think this is the first big start with Paige and Alicia Fox.
Well, yeah, it's a wait and see approach. I mean, I'm still kind of baffled by that picture and her, what she did on Raw, which I'm like, wow. And actually, I was gonna make a particular joke about that though, but I really can't say it though, just because I probably would.
We'd probably need to hit the censor button.
Yeah, which I'm pretty sure if that wouldn't be the case, so I probably get the censor button a lot.
Right.
Because outside of it, it'd just be uncensored.
Well. Of course, a move that we're about to show off.
Oh boy!
We're gonna do a live "What a Maneuver" segment. We all love those.
Yep. So for safety precaution, we're always, for me in particular, I like to make sure everything's out of my freaking pockets. Nothing. Oh, almost forgot my glasses. In case anybody, you know, I do wear glasses besides these.
All right.
So the shades are going off.
All right. In the What a Maneuver segment, we're going to demonstrate Alicia Fox's scissors kick. Now, of course, this move actually originated in Chinese martial arts, mm-hmm. subsidiary of Taekwondo and Picard martial arts.
Mm-hmm.
It was popularized over in the United States in professional wrestling by the legendary Hall of Famer, mm-hmm. the six-time world champion Booker T.
Can you dig it, sucker? Boom!
Uh-huh. And
you sure I shouldn't do it? Maybe I should do it though, because I do get the longer legs.
Well, okay.
all right, you know what? We're gonna go by the directors. Yeah, we're each gonna do one. All right.
So
the dealio, what would happen was, you know, I get nailed in the stomach like this.
Nail in the stomach.
The ropes and.
And it would be where I kick this leg up for momentum. And then drop it down the back of his head, driving him to the ground.
Do that.
Exactly. So right, so now so we'll demonstrate here. He kicks me in the gut.
Like boom. All right. And Okay. Please, God, don't let him hit him. That was a little bit of an epic failure. Sorry.
Now we can do it. All right.
So don't say anything more, you man.
All right.
And that's how you do it, folks. And like I said, kids, don't try this at home. You do this one in particular, you may accidentally hit someone in the head, and you don't want that at all. As I said, folks, kids, and especially kids, do not try this at home. I'm a semi-professional when it comes to this, and I know what I'm doing. So there you go.
I sort of know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Okay. So now we're running a little short on time.
Mm-hmm.
But a quick shout out to a particular wrestler who I feel like has kind of fallen far off the beat. It's late in his career, but I still feel like that he has the potential to do big things. And I'm talking about one, The Big Show.
Oh, yeah.
Someone who proclaimed himself to be the world's largest athlete. He was tired of being the novelty act. He was tired of appealing to kids and children. He just wanted to be the big bad dude. He was tired of being the big cuddly teddy bear. And that was in 2013. And he was a legitimate threat to the WWE World Heavyweight Championship, to any superstar within reach of his KO fist.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, 2014, we haven't really seen much of him except for a little New Year's skit where he came out dressed as the New Year's baby. And
I'm sorry, I couldn't keep the shit game with you.
I wanted to show a picture of that, but I didn't want to scar the viewers. So I'll spare you.
You scarred me, for Pete's sake. Yeah.
Yeah. So just paint a picture of a 450-pound man in a diaper. Pretty much. That's all you need to know. All
right.
But the point is, at this point, Big Show doesn't need a gimmick. He doesn't need a gimmick. He just needs to be the world's largest athlete. He just needs to go out there, knock people out, choke slam them. That's all people really like him for. And that's what he brings to the table. No more stupid little gimmicks. No more like appealing to audiences. Just come out, choke slam, knock out, and then leave.
All right. Well, for my case, though, I mean, since this is the first for me, I'd probably going to have to say, you know, Sheamus is kind of being a little on the iffy side. I mean, yeah, sure. He won a few weeks ago. He won the 20-man Battle Royal for the United States Championship. Okay, yes. But this is his first championship in...
Early last year.
Yeah.
And he's kind of been displaying some bullying tactics. Like, he's been indifferent. He doesn't really care about the fact that Ambrose was unfairly... he had the U.S. title. He had to defend the U.S. title in a 20-man battle royal. And normally Sheamus speaks up for people like that in that sort of case. But this time, he said, "Well, tough luck, fella."
Mm-hmm. No, so, it was the truth, though. I mean, because Dean Ambrose, I don't mean to diss the Shield, though. Even though I do believe me, guys. Dude, you are a worse United States champion. If anything, I'd probably be a heck of a lot better. If I had the power and whatnot, though, I'd be the one defending that every single stinking week if I really want to. In all honesty, I just think Sheamus really needs to, you know, bring back the guy from back in 2010 when he dominated the crud out of...
When he dominated ECW, mm-hmm. when he came to Raw and won the WWE title from John Cena to the shock of everyone.
Yeah. Bring that side of him back, for Pete's sake. Not just the whole jokative thing and whatnot, though. Just take my advice, Sheamus. So just go back to the whole okay, dealio. So,
oh, what?
Did it? Oh, oops. Sorry about that, folks. Technical difficulty.
Technical difficulty right there. So, I mean, it's a good point, and just hopefully for the preview for next week. For our superstar profile,
thanks, Rick.
Will in fact be the United States champion Sheamus for our superstar profile next week.
Oh boy!
Also next week I'm gonna offer my own take on the Shield and next week Disconnected.
Mm-hmm.
go into more detail on where I feel like they're lacking. We'll have Ken's Den. We'll have the Zach Attack. We'll have the next. We'll hopefully have more matches made for WWE Payback. We'll hopefully have an update on Daniel Bryan's neck surgery. Mm-hmm. All that and more. Mm-hmm. But for now, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to wish you a happy weekend.
Yep. But he may claim he's the paper champion, but the real champ is here. Recognize. Stay connected.
Stay connected.
Is like taking a trip down memory lane. The farther from Earth we look, the farther back in time we see.